Great to see you all. Good evening. Can we all please stand up? And before we start, can we raise a big shout to the Lord like the walls of Jericho are falling down? Yeah! Come on, bigger than that. Woo! A hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. A hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. King is alive. I raise a hallelujah with everything inside of me. I raise a hallelujah. I will watch the darkness flee. I raise a belongs to you, Jesus. Hallelujah. You are the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you are Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is, nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus.
The veil tore before you, you silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. You have no right. You are Lord. You are
the earth will magnify your name. All our hearts adore you, Jesus, because you are the risen King. You are the Lord who lives forever. You brought salvation and we received it, Lord. Thank you for eternal life. Thank you for the word of God that is living in our hearts, Lord Jesus. Our hearts are raised up to you. We give you all the glory and we give you all the honor, because you alone are the Lord that is seated on the throne. Bless us tonight and bless your word.
Praise the Lord. Wow. Beautiful worship, huh? Excellent. Thank you, God. What a beautiful week we're having with the play. Wow, they've done a great job with the play. Really, really great. Really good. Really. How many of you have, you were able to see it yesterday? Yeah, good. We had a pretty full house, a lot of visitors, and beautiful message in that play. So, wow, we're thankful. We have a couple of visitors. I think we have Sharon back from Albania, right here. Okay, and she's been a missionary in Albania 4 years, maybe four and a half, then 3 days, and okay, and then Ben. Ben from Thailand, who's right down in the front row here. Great to have him. Ben Munson playing Jesus in the play was excellent last night. Wow. And Luke and then Miles. What a team they are, huh? Laurel and Hardy. I mean, they are a team. They did a great job. And all the, you know, every part of it, Pastor Steve wrote it, and then Leah, the director, and I won't mention all the names that come to my mind, but just saying the prayer and the spirit of God in these days that we are living. We're all sensitive to the tragic collapse of the bridge here in Baltimore, and like looking at it and thinking about it and what happened, and we are sympathetic with the families who lost the husband or dad in the accident. So when we see something like that and it just resonates in our minds, and there's a lot of thinking and processing that goes through our hearts when we see, Jesus said that when you see that when the Tower of Siloam fell, would you turn there with me and look at that for a moment, Luke 13. We shared it in a staff meeting, but I just want to say this because the word is our comforter. And Jesus is saying regarding current events, true tragedies, Pilate slaughtering Galileans. And he's saying, do you think they were sinners above all the Galileans? Do you think that somebody who's caught in a tragic event, do you think that that's because of them? And the second one is verse 4. That, or those 18 upon whom the Tower of Siloam fell and slew them, do you think they were sinners above all men that dwelt in Jerusalem? And he said, no. In verse 5, I tell you, nay, no. What does come to our minds? Well, If we are alive on the earth today, it's the grace of God. And then, very importantly, we have a play where we are communicating to the community, and by all means to say that Christ is the way. And this week of celebration and teaching, there's so many elements of the Easter story that we are saying in our hearts, we want to hear it. We want to grasp a hold of the meaning of it. We want to think about it and realize that God loves us and that God sent his Son into the world for us. And there's no ancient history compared to this one, where we have so much that parallels our lives and so much to learn regarding Passover week, and then that amazing resurrection of Christ from the dead, and what it means to us in our lives, and how precious that is. So I want to draw your attention to one meditation I've had, and this is in Luke. Jesse, would you mind grabbing my glasses over there for me? And we have, thank you, Luke 22, in verse, I made a short with some study today, a short comparison to Peter and Judas Iscariot. I want to share it with you in the beginning here. Verse 3. Then he entered Satan into Judas, named Iscariot, being the number of the 12. I think I could label our words right now by the title, Don't Be Afraid to Make Mistakes. Don't be afraid of life. Don't be afraid of failure. Judas Iscariot was, from one point of view, like the polished guy. He really was. He didn't make any blunder in the Gospels. When we read the Gospels, we don't see him making any blunder. So I looked up the word blunder. It means to move unsteadily or confusedly, to make a mistake through stupidity, ignorance, or carelessness, to utter stupidly or confusedly or thoughtlessly, to make a stupid, careless, or thoughtless mistake. Like Judas wasn't that kind of guy. Actually, on the contrary, there were two forces that he had control over in his life. One was money. He had the money bag. And that's maybe kind of a mystery to us that Jesus would allow him to have the money bag when he was a thief in his heart. Though there's no evidence of him stealing anything in the Gospels. There's no evidence that he said the wrong thing. There's no evidence that he went in the wrong place or that he made a blunder. He wasn't like that. He had the money, and by the way, he's the only disciple who has a last name, Iscariot. Also, I understand he's the only disciple from Judea, the more honorable part of Israel. He was good, polished, capable. The second connection he had was politically, socially, because he was able to leave and go and make his connections with the authorities. And how many times did he meet them And if he did meet them, what was it like? It was like no mistake. It was polished. You could say he was professional. He was capable. He was empowered. On the surface, he's the guy that's succeeding, really. He's the one that has the connections. And when it was time to betray Christ, he knew where to go, he knew who to talk to, and he knew that he could get 30 pieces of silver. That's kind of like a profile of him. And I have a piece on it here. It goes like this. Among the apostles, the one absolutely stunning success was Judas. And the one thoroughly groveling failure was Peter. Judas was a success in the ways that most impress us. He was successful both financially and politically. He cleverly arranged to control the money of the apostolic band. He skillfully manipulated the political forces of the day to accomplish his goal. And Peter was a failure in ways that we most dread. He was impotent in a crisis. That was when Jesus needed him, he wasn't there. Socially inept. You know, we read the Gospels and we see Peter blurting out something or saying, "Can't you see him?" Kind of stumbling along, making mistake, being in the wrong place, kind of, or saying the wrong thing, like the Mount of Transfiguration. If you can say, "That's like me," that's a good thing. If you can say, "I can identify with Peter," and to be honest, that's something like me. I can live with it. Now, here's the last point. When it was finally discovered in Judas's life and in his conscience that he made a mistake, he couldn't live with himself. When he realized he messed up, that was the end. Read it with me, it's actually in Matthew 27. It's interesting because if you look at the end of 26:69, this is for Bible folks that are taking notes, and you can make this note because you don't any longer bring your Bibles to church. God have mercy on us, because we got the screen over here. Matthew 26:69-75, that's Peter denying the Lord and messing up, and he went out and wept bitterly. Now 27:3 down through, we see Judas. And this is the one I want on the screen, 27:3. Then Judas, which had betrayed him, when he saw that he was condemned, repented himself, brought again the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders. He did not repent to God. He was just disappointed with himself. Because he was the guy that kind of was doing things right. He was a guy, so in a social setting, you would feel more secure with Judas's behavior than you would feel with Peter's behavior. Like, "Peter, we're going to be with important people, so just be quiet, okay? Like, don't mess, don't do that." I don't know, should I use this one? Okay. It does irritate. Okay. All right, so, okay. Chapter 27, verse 4. "I have sinned, and then I betrayed the innocent blood. And they said, 'What is that to us? See thou to that.'" Isn't that a great job, guys? Man broken, in trouble, in a crisis, and you don't care about him. What's that to us? You betrayed the innocent blood? What's that? That's your problem. That's not our problem. That's your problem. Verse 5. "He cast down the pieces of silver in the temple and departed and went and hanged himself. Closing part. Peter, he knew what it was to mess up. And he went out and he wept bitterly. But what did he do? What did he do? He was the failure. He was the guy that messed up. But what did he do? He faced it and he lived through it. He lived through the mess. He lived through it. Now, what did Judas do? He messed up and he can't face it. And he hanged himself. That's not the answer, by the way. You still live. You live forever. And that's the tragedy of that whole picture. But in the psychological makeup of these two men, if you're one of those that does mess up, then congratulations. And if you're realistic, if you are real and you're able to say it and go before God, because I believe that Judas could have been saved. How? The same way anybody is. I mean, apart from the sovereignty of God, but I'm saying in principle, I failed. I failed. So what are you going to do about it? I'm going to go to God. I'm going to face it, and I'm going to live through it because God will carry me through. God will save me. God forgives me. God gives me grace. I'm going to learn life. I'm going to learn life maybe the way I should have learned life earlier, but I was too proud to let anybody know. A third thing about Judas is this, which I think is one very powerful, fascinating point, and it is that when Jesus said, "One of you betray me," nobody said, "Is it Judas?" Why? Because he covered it. Because you couldn't read him. Because he was professional. Because he was really good at it. He would be the guy that it just didn't come to their minds. I don't know why, actually, but I'm just playing with it a little bit and wanting you to think with me about it. And finally say, Judas became now the byword of a betrayer. You Judas, the Judas goat, the goat leading the other goats to, you know, the word, byword for a real failure, the ultimate kind of failure, the lost person who cannot face the reality of my loss, and that I need Jesus Christ. I need God to save me. And Peter became the great apostle that we call our sons, Peter. Peter, there's a saying, isn't it? There'll be a time when men will call their dogs Nero and Caesar and call their sons James and Peter. We have a great story there. Let's help people. Let's help people find God. And let's also not portray the image of perfection or professionalism. Let's us just do what we can and admit our problems and our blundering and go on with God and find God. And when we find God, by the way, this is a thing that Judas didn't have. He didn't have freedom. Do you know he didn't have freedom? Judas didn't have freedom. What kind of freedom? He didn't have the freedom to fail. If you don't have the freedom to fail, then you're not free. He didn't have freedom. He didn't know how to live in freedom. He was in a narrow world. And when that narrow world collapsed, and his reputation and everything about him collapsed, and all he had, only one solution was to hang himself. But you and I are people that have freedom, and we have the freedom to fail. And when we fail, we get up again. And when we fail, we go on. Because the life isn't about your profile. It's about God's grace. It's not about your success or mine. It's about who is Jesus and what did Jesus do? What does Jesus do? And how we can move on in life with whatever happens in our life. And it says Peter went out and wept bitterly. And I believe, and Jesus said, I have prayed for you. Satan wants to beat you like wheat, but I prayed for you, and when you are converted, strengthen the brethren. Okay? Is that edifying? Is that good? All right, turn to your neighbor and just talk to them about it for a moment and just say, what did he say? And just talk for a moment about it and worship the Lord for it.
All right. Just a few announcements. Is there anybody here for the very first time that you are visiting our Greater Grace service? We'd like to give you just a little gift. If you could raise your hand, please. We want to welcome you. First time. Welcome. Boom. Right in the middle. I saw that hand. She was waving. Anybody else? And if you didn't raise your hand, you're new, you could go to the front desk. We just want to give you a gift, welcome you. And so other announcements. The Easter play, the other days that we have, Thursday and Friday night at 7 p.m. All right? And then Saturday will be the matinee, they call it, 2 p.m. So Friday and Thursday, 7, Saturday at 2. There are more tickets, please take them on the way out in the Welcome Center. And then also there's a Good Friday service. So our cafe will be open from 11:45 to 12:45, and then we have a service here at 1 p.m. in the chapel. Okay, so that's the Good Friday service. So come on out, and we're just fellowshipping, enjoying opening up the Word and this important week. And wasn't that a good message right there? Yeah? Amen. Yeah, what an amazing thing to think about. And I was thinking, like, Jesus, even when Judas kissed him, Jesus called Judas friend, you know, called him friend. And you can imagine just being broken, being called a friend of God. And even Peter, he got the look from Jesus, right? But Peter was humble. He humbled himself in the end. So, we just want to, and now we're going to pray for the offering, and then we're going to hear from Pastor Love, okay? So let's just pray for the offering. And also your envelopes, Grace Hour envelopes, please keep giving to the Grace Hour. So, Father, we just Yeah, we thank you. Yes, Lord, for this week, God. Just these incredible events. Most all the Gospels really are heavenly depicting these events that happen in this week, Lord. And help us to dive deeper into it, to receive more from it, to pray more, to understand more, and just to reveal to us, God. We can only know what you reveal to us, Lord. And just reveal to us the importance of this week, the importance of the cross, and most importantly, the importance of resurrection life, Lord, through your Son. All of our burdens, all of our sins are on that cross, and we could just humble ourselves and say, I failed. I failed. I'm a failure, Lord. Receive me, God. Forgive me, and you will, because you call us friend, and you love us. Lord, bless this offering, God. Help us to be givers. Just bless the Easter play, all the people that are in it, Lord. Just keep nourishing them, feeding them, giving them energy. Just many hours of commitment they put in, God, and just refresh them each day, Lord. Help us to pray for them, Father, and bring people in, God, to hear this good news, this great message, God. We praise you, and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Just a child when I felt the Savior leading. I was drawn to what I could not understand. And for the cause of Christ, I have spent my days believing that what it had in me is who I am.
Okay, praise God. Boy, what a good word. Amen. You're not free until you have the freedom to fail. I guess that makes us the most free church in Baltimore. Amen. I came under such conviction as he was talking about Judas, because when I was in high school, for 2 years in a row, I ran for class treasurer. I mean, my slogan when I ran the campaign was, let love handle your money. But I have to say, as the class treasurer, I was a lot like Judas. I'll just leave it at that. But thank God for his grace, amen? I just want to share a couple of thoughts to close tonight from Luke chapter 24. It's the story, it's the account that the play is based on. And as Pastor Schaller shared a few minutes ago, what a great opening night last night. The chapel was just really almost full, in a response to the invitation. Many people went forward and accepted Christ as their Savior. So if that's the first night, you can imagine tomorrow night and Friday night and Saturday afternoon. But keep giving out those tickets. Keep inviting folks that you meet, because you never know who might come. So Luke chapter 24, just a quick overview here. The first day of the week, early in the morning, the women came unto the sepulcher, bringing the spices which they prepared, certain others with them. And they found the stone rolled away from the sepulcher. They entered in and found not the body of Jesus. And it came to pass, they were much perplexed. And I thought about that. I wonder what that meant, that they were, you know, greatly or much perplexed. And the Greek text brings out that the word actually means that there was no way out for them. Now think about that. Because of the one who said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, was now in their minds gone. He died. So they don't have a way. The word also spoke of the fact that they have no resources. In other words, without Jesus, it just left them with perplexed hearts. And sometimes, as we move through life as believers, we can become perplexed. And what's the answer to perplexed hearts? An open tomb. It's the answer for people's hearts today. And when you think of this story, how it continues to unfold, Jesus revealed himself to Mary Magdalene, and then the two disciples on the road to Emmaus, which was from Jerusalem to Emmaus about 7 or 8 miles. And they talked together of all the things that had happened. It came to pass while they communed together and reasoned, Jesus himself drew near and went with them. They didn't recognize him. Their eyes did not understand who he was. They did not know him. And he said unto them, what manner of communications are these that you have with one another as you walk and are sad? So clearly, he could see how discouraged they were, maybe disillusioned. And one of them answered, his name was Cleopas, answering him, says, are you a stranger in Jerusalem? Have you not known the things which are come to pass here in these days? And I don't know what Jesus was thinking, but it's like, what are you talking about? And then, what does it say? They said, well, the things concerning Jesus of Nazareth. So here they are telling Jesus about the things about Jesus of Nazareth. And he hadn't revealed himself to them. And then they went on in verse 21. It says, but we had trusted that it would be him who would have redeemed Israel. And besides all this, it's the third day these things were done. And certain women have said that they went to the sepulcher, they found it empty. And, you know, just, I love the fact, too, that they said, well, you know, we envisioned how it was that God was going to deliver us. And it didn't happen that way. And I think we've all been there, haven't we, at one point, a time in our lives or another, where we think, we believe we know how God's going to deliver us. We have an idea of how it's supposed to be done. We believe it's going to happen this way. And we forget that God's ways are like God's thoughts. They're nothing like our thoughts and our ways. And again, they anticipated that Jesus would come and deliver them from Caesar. Jesus is thinking, you don't need to be delivered from Caesar, you need to be delivered from Satan. They think we need to be delivered from the power of Rome. Jesus, again, always doing something even greater than we can even think or imagine, says, no, you need to be delivered from the power of sin. God always does, doesn't he? Exceeding abundantly above all we can ask or think. In Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20. And then he spoke at them and he said, you fools, slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Ought not Christ to have suffered these things and entered into his glory? And then beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. What a Bible study that must have been. Can you imagine, as the living word just takes illustration and example after illustration and example from the Old Testament and talking about the Passover lamb, right? And talking about the great day of atonement and talking about the scapegoat in Leviticus 16 and talking perhaps about Abraham willing to offer his son Isaac. And I can't even begin to imagine the things that he must have said to them. And as he did, what happened? He opened their slow hearts to believe. And how did he do it? With the scriptures. There is nothing quite like the scriptures. I honestly can say, if I came down to church tonight and all I heard, if all I heard was, you are not free unless you have the freedom to fail, that would be enough for me. That will sustain me. That will carry me through the week. I'll get in my car and drive home. And when I get to a bridge, I will drive extremely fast, get to the other side of it. That's the way I'm going across all bridges from now on. Sure, you might think that way too. But really, he opened the scriptures. Isn't it amazing? You think of the wise men. Remember when the wise men were led to find Jesus at his birth? Remember where the star? It was the star. It was a sign that God used to lead them. But where did that star lead them? It led them to Jerusalem, to Herod's palace. And there they said to Herod, where is he that is born the king of the Jews? And what did Herod do? He had enough sense to call for the scribes. And the scribes came forward. And he had the scribes open the scripture. And then they said, in Bethlehem of Judea, according to the prophet Micah. Now, why is that important? Because the sign was used to bring them to Jerusalem, but only the scriptures can bring you to Jesus. The word of God brings us to Jesus, right? I mean, we all had signs in our lives. I remember the sign that got my attention. Jail. It was. I went to jail, and all kinds of events had been leading up until that time, and that was it. That was my sign. But believe me, when I was in jail, I didn't cry out and accept Christ as my Savior. I had to go back and find the people that were telling me about the gospel, and they brought me to a Bible study. And that's where I found Jesus, through the scriptures. What does God do for perplexed hearts? He opens his tomb. And we find it empty. What does he do for slow hearts to believe? He opens the scriptures. What does he do for discouraged hearts? The Bible says, their eyes were opened in verse 31, and they knew him. And then he vanished out of their sights. If God doesn't open our eyes, and I think it's amazing as well when you think of this story. Here's Jesus. What was on his agenda? He's got to go to the cross. He's got to shed his blood for the remission of sins for the whole world. He's got to defeat death. He's got to defeat the devil. He's got to gloriously triumph over sin, death, and the devil. And you would think that that would be enough. No. Before he ascends, he's got to go out of his way, and he's got to find these two discouraged, disillusioned disciples so that he can, again, open their eyes and open their hearts. And eventually, guess what it led to? It led to them in verse 35. They went and they told the things that were done along the way. He opened their lips and gave them joyful hearts. There is a progression in this story that is just so amazing. God will never leave us perplexed. He will never leave our hearts filled with fear and doubt and thinking that we don't have a way out, or we don't know what to do, or we don't know where to turn. He will never let that happen. And he will remind us that an open tomb, and by the way, someone said, yes, that stone had to be rolled away so that Jesus could get out. Nonsense. That stone was rolled away so that we could go in. Find an empty tomb and then become witnesses for a resurrected Christ. He'll never leave us with perplexed hearts. He'll never leave us with slower hearts to believe. He'll reveal himself to us through the scriptures. He'll never leave us with discouraged hearts. He'll open our eyes. And finally, that will lead to you and I opening our mouths and declaring, he is risen again from the dead. He's alive. And he cares, and he loves people enough to go out of his way and find them in their discouragement and to bring them back to the reality of who he is and what he's done for them. Amen? Amen. Let's pray together. Lord, thank you. As we close our service tonight, maybe there's a heart here tonight that needs to be enlightened, a heart that needs to be opened, and a heart that needs to allow you to come in and live, reveal yourself. If you're here tonight and you've never trusted Christ in a personal way, never believed on him, that's all it takes. You just trust him. You just believe him. And he accepts you and cleanses you and sets you free. Lord, if someone's here tonight and they're going to make that decision, just open their hearts, open their eyes, open the scriptures to them so that they might see who you are, and let them trust you tonight. Anyone here making that decision to believe on Jesus, just raise your hand, put it up, and just put it right back down. The ushers have a gift they want to give you. Anyone tonight? Father, thank you for our service tonight. Thank you for what we've heard. Thank you for your presence. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please let's stand up for closing. I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. I'm from the ashes, hope will arise.
All right, so Pastor Love's message, the two guys that are kind of slow of heart to believe, they're not the sharpest knife in the drawer, right? They're not on it. How about you? Are you sometimes like dull, not on it, slow of heart to believe the prophets? What about that? How about Peter went out and wept bitterly, but life's not over, right? I love that. Jesus comes to us like the blundering, you know, the things that aren't, you know, Jesus comes, he ministers to us. Isn't that good? That was great. Pastor Love, that was great. Also, his closing at the play last night was so good. Really was. The Lord's doing work here. And just keep these days in prayer. And I'm just very thankful for the body of Christ. And let's have a prayer for those families that lost someone in the bridge collapse the other day. Lord Jesus, we pray these are Latino families in Dundalk. And one, I believe he was the father of six children. And they are precious, and I believe belong to a Catholic church there. And we just pray for comfort. We pray for strength. We pray for them. And others that we don't know of course, in life, may we be there. And may Jesus use us to help others that make mistakes and stumble along in life and need the God of all grace. We ask you, Lord, to teach us grace for ourselves and for other people. Thank you for this week. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. You're dismissed.